You've probably seen the 1992 classic film Juice countless times. After over 30 years of watching this movie, we noticed something about the exaggerated events that happened in the film that was in our faces the entire time. In the early part of the movie Juice, we see four teenage friends, Bishop, played by Tupac, Q, played by Omar Epps, Raheem, played by Khalil Kane, and Steel, played by Jermaine Hopkins, skip school and watch the movie White Heat. What if all of the events in the movie Juice that happened after Bishop and his friends watched the movie were simply part of Bishop's twisted fantasy, fueled by his desire to have the power and juice that he so desperately wanted?
I think you're exaggerating.
I know. You already want to say this is impossible, but let us explain all of the clues in the movie that add up to the very plausible alternate theory, fan theory, that Bishop, inspired by the movie White Heat, had a very active imagination.
I'm Heit.
And I'm Cheri. And today, we're here to count down all of the evidence and clues within the movie Juice that support our alternate theory that most of what happened in the movie was Bishop's daydream.
Right. And I want to emphasize that this is just our alternate theory about the movie. We don't need you to explain the common interpretation of the film as if we don't already understand that.
Exactly. The movie is a work of fiction. It's art, open to interpretation. So just about anything is possible as long as there's evidence in the film to back it up.
Right, Cheri. And don't start making comments right now about how we're wrong, because we've probably addressed your objection already in this video.
If you like our fan theories, please consider supporting the channel by clicking the join button to become a member, or by making a one-time contribution by clicking the thanks button on this video.
All right, here it goes.
As the movie Juice opens, we see each friend getting ready for school. This is when we first see Bishop and his father. As a viewer, you're wondering, what's wrong with Bishop's father? As you see the older man staring blankly at the TV as if he's mesmerized. He doesn't even turn to Bishop when Bishop tells him goodbye for the day.
Take it easy, Pop.
Also note that Bishop's chain has a gun charm on it.
Next, Bishop is shown walking down the street with Too Short song, So You Wanna Be a Gangsta, playing.
So you wanna be a gangster.
Yo, Bishop!
And yes, Bishop wants to be a gangster. Shortly after this, we see Bishop engage in an altercation with Rodamies, the leader of a Puerto Rican crew, outside of a convenience store.
The confrontation is sparked because Rodamies is upset that Bishop has been talking behind his back. The fact that Bishop would rather talk behind Rodamies' back than confront him head on shows us that he has a level of cowardice that will become more apparent as the movie progresses. Interestingly, Rodamies is the first to make reference to the term juice when he asks Bishop whether he thinks he's got that much juice.
You got that much juice?
Bishop is clearly getting punked until he sees that his crew is close enough to rescue him. Then he puffs up and starts talking trash. In response, Rodamies makes a reference to Bishop's father's sexuality and says that he heard that he likes being a prison yard hoe.
Luckily, Raheem with the other guys are there to intervene and save Bishop from certain fate of taking a beating.
Hey, it's cool, man. It's cool.
We later learn that Bishop takes routine beatings from Rodamies and his crew because Steel makes a reference to it when they are at Steel's house.
You can't even walk your own block without getting fucked up by Rodamies, let's not forget.
Next, we see the guys in a pool hall where Q is peddling his party tapes and Bishop and Steel play video games. We gain even more insight into Bishop during this scene in terms of how he clearly bullies Steel, making him pay for a game for each of them, and also telling them that he will beat Steel's ass whether he loses or wins.
For one, if I lose, I'ma beat that ass. For two, if I lose, I'ma beat that ass.
Bishop treats Steel as an aggressive bully, but he can only play a defensive role when dealing with Rodamies.
The fun at the pool hall doesn't last for long before cops show up and chase the guys out of the place. Bishop and Q find themselves escaping through a maze of alleys, and Bishop's coat gets caught on a gate, and Q has to rescue him. They eventually wind up on a rooftop. Now, if you remember the final scene of the film, you'll know that this is some serious foreshadowing. This time around, Bishop and Q make their final escape from the cops by leaping to another rooftop.
That's right. Later, we see three of the guys waiting for Steele outside of school. In a shot of the guys walking down the street, notice their formation. Q and Raheem are in the front, with Bishop and Steele, the wannabes, trailing behind them. Bishop wants to be the leader, but he knows his place in his friend group, and he's third in line at best.
Yep. Q notices a poster for a DJ competition and decides he wants to enter. The guys head to the record shop to get records for Q's demo. We see Q flirt with the store clerk to distract her while Bishop, Raheem, and Steele steal music and exit the shop. It's important to note here that both Q and Raheem are established as being successful with the ladies, while it seems doubtful that Bishop and Steele are getting any play.
On the way to Steele's house, the guys decide to stop at a bar for cigarettes, sending Q in to get the smoke since they are all underage. While inside, Q runs into a guy that he knows, Blizzard, who proceeds to rob the place and ask Q if he wants in on it.
Yeah, pardon me for a second. I'm about to rob this place.
All right, everybody, put your hands in the air and face the fucking bar.
Q is rightfully shaken by what's going down, so he hurries up and exits while the robbery is still taking place.
Here's a funny note. Did you notice how Q was carrying an EPMD record he stole right before the scene where we see EPMD in the bar as two of the patrons being robbed?
Oh man, classic. So when Q goes outside and tells the guys that Blizzard is robbing the bar, we see Bishop appear to be excited to go inside and take part in a robbery. Raheem holds him back and tells him they aren't going down like that. But what's really going on here? Was Bishop really going to participate in the robbery? When you take a closer look at Bishop's body language, it seems like he's the person who is always hyped up, about to fight, but they know that their friends are going to hold him back, even though they had no intention of fighting in the first place.
Yup. So the guys finally make it to Steele's house, where the movie White Heat is playing on TV. Bishop seems particularly inspired by it, becoming animated and yelling at the TV.
Gotta go out, that's how you go out.
Now, we went and watched the movie White Heat so you wouldn't have to. And what we found out after the movie is the key to understanding the movie Juice in general and our fan theory in particular.
Yes, Cheri. The movie White Heat, released in 1949, is the story of Cody Jarrett, a psychopathic criminal who leads numerous heists and eventually breaks out of jail. At its core, White Heat is about who has the juice, the power and influence, to be the top dog of the crew. We see this power struggle over who's got the juice play out throughout the film, White Heat.
Yep. The underlying themes in White Heat and Juice are essentially the same. One difference between Cody and Bishop is that Cody has an unhealthy attachment to his mother, while Bishop didn't appear to have a mother present in his life at all. He lived with his father and grandmother. We saw that in the movie. Another little interesting nugget of information about White Heat is that Cody has these reoccurring headaches in the film, and these headaches cause his vision to go blurry and induce kind of a montage of bad memories.
It's like having a red-hot buzzsaw inside my head.
Almost like a short daydream or a dream sequence.
Mm.
Just like what happens with Bishop in the movie Juice.
Aha. Uh-huh.
Mm-hmm.
So back to Juice and the guys watching the movie. After the movie goes off, a news report breaks in and tells that Blizzard is dead as a result of that robbery that we had seen earlier.
Oh shit, it's Blizzard!
A gunman was killed in a shootout with police as he attempted to rob the Harlemwood bar in Harlem just under an hour ago.
While Bishop is staring into the screen, we see his face go blank and look just like his father did earlier in the film while he was watching TV. According to our Juice fan theory, this is where Bishop's fantasy begins. Right after Bishop's long stare, we even see a cut that indicates time has lapsed while Bishop is looking out of the window.
Yes, and everything that we see from this point on in the movie is completely exaggerated and almost completely unbelievable. Let's talk about some of these exaggerated events that occur during Bishop's fantasy.
All right. The first thing we see after the fantasy starts is Bishop snapping on his friends, blaming them for Blizzard's death because they weren't there to back him up during the robbery.
That's because we
wasn't there to back him up.
He's understandably emotional over Blizzard's death, but we haven't seen Bishop stand up to his friends this way before this point in the movie.
Right. So during his rant, Bishop tells the guys that you gotta be willing to die if you want the juice.
You gotta be ready to go down, stand up and die for that shit like Blizzard did if you want some juice.
He was serious and actually fought Q. In this scene, Bishop is confrontational the way he wishes he had the courage to be before. Raheem plays the peacemaker.
Bishop, I want you and Q to settle this shit right now.
And the scene ends with Bishop agreeing that things are cool between he and Quincy. But the lie detector determined that was a lie.
The next crazy, unrealistic thing we see is 16 or 17-year-old Q's girlfriend, Yolanda, is a fully grown divorced woman who is a nurse played by Cindy Herron of the group In Vogue. It's not like they were just sleeping together. He was supposed to be her actual man.
Crazy. And to give this even more context from the time when the movie Juice was released in 1992, you gotta understand that the group In Vogue was one of the hottest R&B groups at the time. And Cindy was the member of the group who arguably received the most attention, singing lead much of the time. So for those of you who weren't around to experience the 90s firsthand, imagine one of today's hottest and most desirable singers or rappers like Rihanna, Nicki Minaj, or Cardi B being shown dating a teenage boy from Harlem. It would be laughable and clearly a fantasy of the young man.
To further our point, they even juxtapose Q against her actual grown man, ex-husband, in a scene. And he is supposed to be even more of a man than an actual grown man, despite being an actual child.
Just crazy. It was one thing when Q was able to land the record store clerk's phone number before this fantasy begins, but we've all got to agree that his relationship with Yolanda is just completely unrealistic.
Yep. We believe the reason Bishop's fantasy has Q with the grown woman is because this is how Bishop views Q's life.
Mm-hmm.
From the outside looking in, Bishop's jealousy of Q has him thinking that Q is so smooth he's pulling grown women and having full relationships with them. But when you understand that this is a high school boy's fantasy, it all makes sense. Bishop may even be conflating the previous record store interaction into a whole new relationship with Yolanda. In fact, as you'll see in the other evidence we present for this theory, Bishop is really kind of obsessed with Q because he is one of the so-called alpha males in the group.
Mm-hmm. And the next unrealistic thing that happens is we learn that Raheem and the other guys have decided to rob the local convenience store while Q was at auditions for the DJ battle. It doesn't make sense that Raheem, who was ready to fight Bishop over not participating in Blizzard's robbery of the bar that led to his death, would suddenly agree or plan a robbery and secure the pistol.
Bruh. But it does make sense when you consider that Raheem is one of the clear leaders of the group and Bishop's inner desire is for the leader to side with his will instead of Q's. So in his devious daydream, Bishop sees Raheem as completely different and more sinister than he was in real life before this daydream even starts.
Exactly. We all know that there is no way that Raheem goes from saying that he's protecting the lives of his crew by not letting them participate in Blizzard's armed robbery to helping plan an armed robbery of his own within hours.
Yeah, some of you will probably say that Raheem and Bishop's outrage over Blizzard's death becomes the motivation for the robbery. But during that argument that happens at Steele's house, Raheem is clearly on Q's side, but he tries to play the role of intermediary to squash the conflict between Bishop and Q.
And as you'll see moving forward, each of the characters becomes less and less like themselves as the daydream progresses. But make no mistake, Raheem does not agree with Bishop when this conflict initially occurs. It's only after we get deeper into the daydream and Bishop's imagination begins to run wild that we see Raheem suddenly switch sides and now he's spearheading an armed robbery.
That's right. So back to this ill-fated robbery, Raheem supplies the gun, and when Bishop sees it, he has that gleam in his eyes that lets the viewer know that this heist will not go as planned. The guys are planning to use Q's DJ competition as an alibi for the time when the robbery takes place.
We see Q participate in the first round of the DJ competition against DJ Majesty. And while his opponent's mixing and scratching records, the song says he wanted all the juice over and over and over again. It's almost like this is Bishop's subconscious mind reinforcing his desire for power and influence over and over while he's experiencing this daydream.
He wanted the juice on loop.
Yes, he wanted all the juice.
We're also reminded of Bishop's jealousy of Q when the crowd is shouting Q after he finishes competing.
Congratulations, Q. You're on your way to the finals. But don't get sloppy, because it don't get any easier, baby.
Bishop is clearly jealous and hating that Q is getting the kind of attention and recognition that he himself wants. Even in his own fantasy, Bishop can't get from under Q's shadow.
That's for sure. So the guys quickly leave the competition and set out to commit the robbery of the convenience store owned by Fernando Quiles. Raheem hits the register while Bishop holds Mr. Quiles at gunpoint, with Q standing lookout at the door.
Once they got the money and are ready to leave, Raheem says, "All right, let's go."
All right, let's go.
Whole time, Mr. Quiles is begging for his life.
Please don't shoot me, all right?
Just you don't shut the fuck up.
Raheem repeats, "Let's go." And then Bishop fires into the back of Mr. Keyless' head. The other three guys are shocked that Bishop did that.
I know I'd have been shocked too. You can see the fear in their eyes, which are the only parts of their faces that are exposed while wearing the ski masks. They panic and run out of the store into an alley where they freak out.
Raheem freaks out and yells at Bishop that he didn't have to kill Mr. Keyless.
You didn't have to shoot him, man.
You made a move.
Raheem and Q agrees that they need to get rid of the weapon which Bishop is still holding.
You got to get rid of the fucking gun.
Yeah, you're right, man.
Bishop says that he's holding on to the piece until he says so and then aims it at Raheem.
Yo, Bishop, man, give me the piece.
I mean, I'm holding on to this till I say so.
A tussle ensues and Bishop shoots Raheem in the chest and then digs in his pocket to retrieve the money from the robbery. Raheem grabs Bishop's arm as he moves to leave him for dead. Of course, we know that this is the end of Raheem.
So what are Bishop's motives for his actions at this point? We know that he is jealous of Q, he is upset by Raheem being the respected leader of the crew, and he targeted Mr. Quiles because earlier in the film, the old man pulled a gun on the guys when they were arguing with Rodamies in front of the store, and quite frankly, he wanted a body. Bishop equated bodies with juice.
Bishop ultimately wanted Raheem out of the way so that he could be the leader of the crew. But before this daydream turned nightmare, he never had the nerve to assert himself like this.
The crew flees from where they left Raheem's body to an abandoned building. Steele is distraught and whimpering in a corner when Bishop yells at him to shut up. This is another sign that everything in this daydream is really over the top.
Yeah, I mean, we talked about how in the daydream, Raheem suddenly becomes a hardened criminal when there was no sign of this before the daydream starts. Well, there are significant changes in Steele's character, too. Before the daydream starts, Steele is probably the lowest rank in the crew, but he's not the sniveling crybaby he becomes after the daydream starts.
While it's true that Bishop bullied him into paying for his games at the arcade, in a daydream, Steele's character becomes this over-the-top crybaby, which is in complete contrast to Bishop, who has asserted himself as the new leader of the crew.
Yeah. So after they escape to an abandoned building, instead of figuring out what to do next, Bishop decides that this is the perfect time to count up the money from the robbery.
Don't y'all see how much money we got?
Q tells Bishop that he is going crazy.
You going crazy, B?
And Bishop holds the gun to his head and tells him never to call him crazy.
You ever fucking call me crazy again, I'll blow your fucking brains out.
Bishop then terrorizes Steele and immediately consoles him, telling them that they're all in this together.
We all in this shit together. Fight that shit, come on.
Clearly, Bishop is the one who is unraveling, despite him accusing Steele of being the one who is cracking up.
I know, just crazy. So next, Bishop justifies killing Raheem by saying Raheem grabbed for the gun.
You saw that. I told him, man. He had no business grabbing the gun like that.
Who is he trying to fool? They were all there and they know that this is a bold-faced lie. But Bishop is the one who has the weapon, so they weren't going to argue with him.
Bishop tells the guys if they have a problem with what he did to Raheem, they can deal with it right now, whilst holding the gun, of course.
And if anybody got a problem with it, we can deal with it right now.
Bishop escorts the guys to leave to go back to the competition at gunpoint. He hides the gun under a brick in an abandoned building.
Q continues with the competition, head spinning from Raheem's killing and the robbery events. In the middle of Q's performance, detectives show up and pull the guys out of the competition. Bishop tells them Raheem is dead, as if he wasn't the one who just did it.
Bruh. This is yet another sign that we're experiencing Bishop's daydream with him. First of all, there's absolutely no way that the cops show up to the DJ competition within mere minutes of Raheem's murder.
I know, cops be slow. Just think about it. When the police show up and find Raheem, they have to process the scene and identify him. There is no way that the cops know who Raheem is and where he is in time to show up to the DJ competition within minutes of Bishop taking Raheem down and finding one of his friends in the sea of people.
Yeah, but when you understand that we are experiencing Bishop's daydream, it all makes sense. In dreams, time doesn't pass the same way as it does in real life, and outlandish things in dreams can seem realistic to the person experiencing the dream, no matter how illogical.
Mm-hmm. However, to the viewer, this sequence of events makes absolutely no sense unless you, the viewer, recognize that everything we see is how things are playing out in Bishop's mind during this fantasy daydream.
Another crazy thing is when the cops show up. Notice how Bishop steps in front of the cops to be the one to deliver the news that Raheem is dead. In what world is a teenager sidestepping the cops like this, pushing them out the way and stuff?
Mm-hmm.
In Bishop's fantasy world, because he thinks he has the juice.
I know, right? Next, we see the interrogation scenes with each of the guys. Steele is seen with tears streaming down his face the entire time he's being interrogated. Q seems nervous, but holds up well to the questioning. Bishop is over the top, smiling, joking, and even smoking a cigarette during interrogation.
In this daydream, Bishop makes himself the cool one under pressure. He even tells the detectives that he was in the basement with an old girlfriend as an alibi during the time of both crimes.
Went to the basement for a little while. I ran into an old girlfriend.
We all know that Bishop isn't a ladies' man, and that there is no indication before the daydream starts that he had any success with the ladies. But in this daydream, his daydream, it is supposed to be a believable alibi that he was with a lady during the time in question. Yeah, right.
During questioning about Mr. Keyless' robbery, we see Steele breaking under pressure and admitting that their crew harassed Mr. Keyless.
Your gang regularly harassed Mr. Keyless.
No, because we're not a gang.
Yeah, we ain't kill him though.
This is continued reinforcement of Steele as the weakest member of the crew during the daydream.
Of course, Bishop makes himself the hero of his daydream during the interrogation by suggesting that Rodamiz, the head of the Puerto Rican crew, had the motive to do Raheem in.
If anybody had a motive to do Raheem in, it would have been Rodamiz.
The detectives ask why Q is so nervous, and he responds that we three niggas in a police station, it doesn't matter what happened. If you want us to be guilty, we'll be guilty.
Because we're three niggas in a police station, it doesn't matter what happened. If y'all want us to be guilty, we'll be guilty.
Even in the daydream, this message that the cops have the ultimate control over who will be accused and viewed as guilty is loud and clear.
Message. In spite of clear indications that the guys had something to do with the incidents involving Keyless and Raheem, they were obviously let go with no explanation in the daydream, because the next scene we see is Raheem's repass.
The scene opens with Steele and Q sitting on a sofa among other mourners, admitting to each other that they are both scared. Remember, this is Bishop's daydream about being the one with the juice, which is why the idea that Quincy and Steele are the weaker ones under pressure is constantly reinforced.
We also can't overlook the cliche of Amazing Grace playing in the background of this scene. Anytime the audience is supposed to feel sad about a funeral scene, Amazing Grace or Precious Lord will be played absolutely 100% of the time.
Despite the cliche spiritual playing in the background, this is arguably the saddest scene in the movie, where we see the impact of Raheem's loss on his family and friends.
Well, all except for Bishop, who shows up like an undercover psychopathic predator with his false concern and syrupy sweet and frighteningly cordial demeanor as he consoles Raheem's mother and sister. Part of Bishop seeing himself as having the juice in his daydream involves the other people in his crew fearing him because he comes off as crazy and willing to engage in the boldest behavior. This is probably his subconscious mind making a parallel between he and his father, who clearly has mental health issues.
The fear factor hits home at the moment when Bishop is hugging Raheem's mother and looks over her shoulder, making eye contact with Q. Bishop wants to be both feared and respected as the leader of the crew, so this is how it plays out in his daydream.
Next, we see that Q has begun avoiding Bishop, presumably because he's afraid of him now. Q's little brother also informs him that the streets are talking and saying that he was arrested related to the Raheem and Keyless incidents.
Quincy is apparently so shook that he decides to hide from Bishop by returning to school. Nevertheless, Q can run, but he can't hide from Bishop in Bishop's daydream, and we see the iconic confrontation at Q's locker.
Bishop claims that he's just there to check in with Q and tells him to forget about what happened. Quincy pushes back and tells Bishop not to pull a gun on him again.
But don't you ever pull a gun on me again in your life.
And Bishop says he hopes he won't have to.
Well, I hope I won't have to.
Bishop then tells Q that he's finally acting like a man, presumably because he stands up for himself.
The brother finally decides to stand up like a man and throw down.
This is another indication that we are not looking at reality, but instead are experiencing this daydream with Bishop.
Quincy has always stood up for himself before the daydream starts, making the decision not to participate in Blizzard's robbery, and even during the daydream when he knew that Bishop had a weapon. So this idea that Quincy hasn't conducted himself like a man is simply a delusional statement in the midst of Bishop's daydream.
During the exchange, Q calls Bishop crazy and he says he was mad the first time he said it, but he agrees and says Q is right and that he doesn't give a fuck.
Crazy, man. When you said that last time, I was kind of tripping, right? But now, you're right. I am crazy. I don't give a fuck.
Bishop lashes out further by telling Q that he doesn't give a fuck about him, Steel, or Raheem.
I don't give a fuck about you. I don't give a fuck about Steel, and I don't give a fuck about Raheem either.
He goes on to confess that he doesn't give a fuck about himself.
I don't give a fuck about myself.
That he ain't shit and ain't never gonna be shit.
I ain't shit. I ain't never gonna be shit.
This is when Bishop's real feelings about himself are expressed for the first time in the movie. His daydream is a safe place to admit the brokenness and hopelessness that he has inside.
When you think about it, all of his actions to this point made it obvious that Bishop had a low self-concept, but to hear him actually say it is quite sad. It makes me wonder whether someone had told him that he would never amount to anything and he internalized this.
Remember in Boyz in the Hood how Doughboy's mother went on a similar tirade, telling him he wasn't shit and would never amount to anything? Reminds me of that.
You ain't shit. You just like your daddy. You don't do shit, and you never gonna amount to shit.
Of course, Bishop has to add a threat at the end of his confession to save face, and he tells Q that he is even less of a man than him, and that he would do him in as soon as he decides that Q ain't gonna be shit.
So soon as I decide that you ain't gonna be shit,
we have to remember that Bishop is jealous of Q, most of all because Quincy is actually trying to become something in his life. He's got an internal drive and sense of direction that Bishop just doesn't have. We talked about this in a previous video we did, talking about how nobody believed in Q besides himself.
Q and Steel walk down the street talking about how crazy Bishop has become and how he claims he's got all the juice now and anyone who comes against him will end up like Raheem and Keyless.
Hey, seriously, man, he was talking some way out shit last night about how he got more juice than everybody else on the street. I learned not to fuck with us to end up like Raheem and Keyless, man.
At the same time, we see Rodemies confront Bishop in the arcade, because he's directed the police to suspect him of committing Raheem and Keyless incidents.
Well, well, looky here. It's the idea telling the cops, I killed Raheem.
This is a repeat of when we saw Rodemies confronting Bishop at the beginning of the movie before the daydream. But instead of rescuing Bishop like they did before, Q and Steel choose to walk away.
Well, actually, Steel wants to go and help him, but Q holds him back and they turn and go in the other direction. Of course, this sets up Bishop to get revenge on his friends later.
But first, Bishop has to deal with Rodemies and his crew. Just as in any other unrealistic daydream, you'll have to suspend reality to believe things went down like this. But with a knife to his nose, Bishop single-handedly begins throwing fists at Rodemies' crew. And just when they're about to get the best of him, the cops roll up and everyone runs away.
Bruh. Bishop pulls the gun from his boot and chases Rodemies into an alley where he unloads on him in broad daylight while cops are chasing them, and just simply walks away.
Next, we see Q going into a neighborhood hangout to get some protection from Sweets, an older lady. Turns out that Sweets knows Q's mother, and she gives him a pistol for free, despite him claiming to only have $25. Clearly, this is yet another unrealistic thing that happens in Bishop's daydream. This woman just happens to know Q's mother and gives him a gun for free. Okay.
We can't overlook what is really happening here, though. The idea of mothers is significant in the movie Juice because we see the impact of everyone else's mother besides Bishop. His envy of Q goes beyond just his career aspirations and appeal to the ladies.
Bishop is also jealous that the other crew members, especially Q, have a mother and he doesn't. Again, these are his subconscious feelings coming to surface in his daydream.
In the following scenes, we see Q tell his fully grown girlfriend, Yolanda, that he knows who killed Raheem.
Know who killed him.
Bishop's daydream is painting Q as a snitch in order to justify what he plans to do to Q.
A phone call from Steel interrupts their conversation. Steel tells Q he's at the pool hall with Bishop, and Q, recognizing that Steel is in grave danger, runs out to go save Steel from Bishop.
I'll speak to you later, all right? I gotta go.
And unsurprisingly, Bishop decides to enact revenge on Steel first by luring him into an alley stairwell where he shoots him after saying that the three ain't crew no more.
Before he pulls the trigger, though, Bishop points out how scared Steel is.
See how scared you are?
This is a significant statement because Bishop's desire is for people to fear him and respect him.
He enjoys the moment of knowing that Steel is afraid of him. Truth be told, even in the daydream, Bishop's fantasy, the only reason anyone in the movie becomes afraid of him is because he has a weapon. Otherwise, they typically disregard him.
As we move toward the finale of Bishop's daydream, we see Bishop telling Tripp, the owner of the hangout joint played by Samuel L. Jackson, that Q is acting funny and to watch him because he might do something to Steel.
Watch that nigga, man. He on some shit. I don't know what's wrong with him. Man, I don't know what he might do to Steel.
Even in the daydream, Tripp knows something ain't right with Bishop, and we see him give him the side eye on his attempt to get Q caught up. Of course, the viewer knows Bishop has already done Steel dirty, and this is his feeble attempt to cover his tracks.
In the meantime, Q arrives just in time to see Steel being loaded into an ambulance. People on the scene begin whispering and pointing at Q, and the police begin chasing him. We see Bishop watching from the rooftop while all of this is taking place.
Seeing Bishop from this vantage point looking down on all of the action is an important element in his daydream. Bishop is not only in the daydream, but he is a silent observer of the events that happen when he's actually not present.
Bishop on the rooftop looking down on the scene is emblematic of how he sees everything that's going on in the daydream. And yet again, in a matter of minutes, Bishop has convinced everyone in the neighborhood that Q was responsible for what happened to Steel before anyone could know what happened.
Quincy takes refuge from the cops in the storage room at Tripp's place, where Tripp informs him that word on the street is that he killed Raheem, Keyless, and Rodemies.
You done slid down a razor blade and landed in an alcohol river. Word is, you killed Raheem. and Quillis and Rodomy.
Q gets Tripp to tell Bishop to meet him alone at midnight.
I want him to meet me tonight alone. Tell him meet me there at 12.
Now, we can't overlook the significance and symbolism of 12 midnight as the chosen meeting time in Bishop's daydream. The word midnight is significant throughout the Bible. It is usually used in connection with an outstanding event, an event related to either salvation or to judgment. The time midnight signifies that there will be both salvation and judgment in the final showdown between Q and Bishop.
On the way to meet Bishop, we see that Q is so shaken by recent events that he actually pulls his piece on a non-housed person who startles him in a dark alley.
Bishop's daydream is beginning to portray Quincy as the one who is descending into madness now. He comments to himself, "What's happening to me?
Damn, man, what the fuck is happening to me?"
And then does the unthinkable. Q actually takes the gun and tosses it into the river.
He went and got a gun and just tossed it.
Same day.
We've got to remember, though, that we're in the daydream of Bishop, the one who is becoming unhinged in real life.
There's no way in the real world Quincy would toss his pistol into the Hudson River when he knows that he's on the way to meet Bishop, who is most certainly going to be armed. Absolutely no way Q would do this.
The more grandiose Bishop's dream becomes, the more it unravels in terms of him being the triumphant hero.
Mm-hmm. Steele is shown in the hospital and the doctors say that he's going to make it.
You'll be fine.
Big fail in his own daydream on taking Steele out.
And guess who Steele's nurse? Yolanda, Q's fully grown girlfriend, just happened to be working at night and Steele tells her that it was Bishop who shot him and everyone else and that he's trying to frame Q that same night.
What happened?
Bishop shot me. He shot everybody. He's trying to frame Q.
Q was just there and he called. She done made it into work, bruh.
She's there on the scene. In the meantime, Bishop shows up at the meeting place and somehow is able to slowly walk up on Q while his back is turned and holds the revolver to his head.
Bruh.
Now, come on. This is yet another indication that the daydream has jumped the shark, because if Q was really so jumpy as to pull his piece out on a non-housed person for startling him, how is it that he's standing, waiting for a known killer, but he never turns around and Bishop is able to slowly sneak up on him? There is no way this happens in real life.
No way. And Bishop demands Q's pistol, saying he heard he copped the piece from Sweets.
Where's the gun? Heard you copped the piece from Sweets today.
Now, how in the real world does it get back to Bishop that Q got a piece? Short answer, it doesn't get back to him in the real world, only in a dream.
It's not like Bishop was all-seeing and had friends who would report back to him and tell him where Q had been and what he was up to.
Also, just think about it. Sweet's establishment was full of older people. They wouldn't be reporting back to Bishop like that. But in his daydream, Bishop is all-seeing, and that's the only way these events are possible as shown. We're in Bishop's daydream where he has so much juice he knows everything that's going on in the hood.
I know, right? So Q tells Bishop that he threw the gun in the river.
I threw it in the river. The stupid motherfucker.
Quincy goes on to tell Bishop, with the revolver pointed in his face, that he might get him now, but sooner or later it's gonna come back to you.
You might get me now, but sooner or later it's gonna come back to you.
At this point in the daydream, Q is representative of what's left of Bishop's conscience, trying to convince him to be reasonable.
Bishop then explains his grand plan is that he would claim self-defense because Q is the one who shot Keyless, Raheem, Rodomies, and Steele, and that he, Bishop, is the one who had the guts to stop him.
See, this is your gun, Q. You was coming to get me, just like you got Raheem, Rodomies, Quillas, and Steele. I was just the only one man enough to take it from you.
The only one who had the guts, right? Bishop's conscience has Q appealing to him by saying that he doesn't have to put on a front for him. If this doesn't expose who Bishop really is, nothing will.
It's me and you, Q and Bishop. You ain't got to put on no front for me, man.
Bishop persists, telling Q that he's the past and that his time is now, and asks Q if he's ready to die.
You the past, bro. My time is now. You ready to die, nigga?
Q responding yes to this question knocks Bishop off his square for long enough for Q to punch Bishop, knocking the gun away. The distraction is enough to allow Q to escape, with Bishop shooting after him.
Yeah, because you know, like in dreams, you don't exactly know what's going to happen, even though your subconscious is playing a part.
Mm-hmm.
Bishop gives chase and they wind up in an elevator full of people. Now get ready for some more completely unbelievable foolishness, because Q looks Bishop dead in the face and says, "What you gonna do, shoot me in an elevator?"
What are you gonna do, shoot me in an elevator?
Bishop literally raises his gun and shoots toward Q in an elevator full of people. In what world does this happen?
He pretty much misses everybody in a full elevator, and a random man, tries to grab the gun from Bishop's hand. And this gives Q enough cover to knock the gun away from Bishop, and a bystander quickly grabs the gun and puts it in his own coat.
That was kind of funny, because the dude is just like, "Excuse me, I'm gonna just take this gun and put it in my coat." So who knows where that gun will turn up later. So next we see Q walking through a house party where Cypress Hill's "How I Could Just Kill a Man" plays in the background as he slowly hunts for Bishop. The tables have turned. Now Q has become the hero of Bishop's daydream.
Oh my God, Bishop is so lame.
Lame.
Q eventually sees Bishop and chases him to the rooftop.
Bishop, come here!
This is reminiscent of the real life rooftop scene at the beginning of the movie when the two friends escaped from the cops by leaping from roof to roof. This is the final showdown for these two lifelong friends. This is similar to Cody's "Made It My" scene in White Heat atop the gas storage tank.
Made It My! Top of the world!
Yep. But one thing you probably didn't notice is the carrier pigeons in a coop on the rooftop as Q searches for Bishop. Carrier pigeons relay messages. So in this scene, they symbolize that a final message is going to be delivered during the scene.
The two guys begin fighting, and Q takes a shot that knocks Bishop over the edge of the roof. He reaches down and grabs Bishop's arm as Bishop begs Q not to let him go.
Q, don't let me go!
Q reassures him that he has him, but Bishop slips from his grasp.
I got you, Bishop, man, come on, hold on.
And we hear him crying out as he falls into darkness, ending with a loud thud. I mean, you hate to laugh at this part, but I don't know. Years later, it was funny to me.
Yeah.
He's like, oh.
Remember the reference you made to Midnight earlier?
Mm-hmm.
Now, we see who got the salvation and who got the judgment.
I know, right? Also notice how the ending of Bishop is very phony and dreamlike, the way he just falls and is consumed by a sea of darkness.
Yeah. Q walks back through a sea of angry faces on the rooftop when one guy stops him and says, "Yo, you got the juice now, man." And the movie ends on a freeze frame of Q's face that fades into a scene of the four friends in happier times.
Of course, after all of this, Bishop blinks a couple times and he's back at Steele's house where the daydream began.
Yep. At the end of the movie, White Heat, Cody literally says he's made it to the top of the world, and yet it blew up in his face. This is exactly what happened in Bishop's fantasy.
Yes, he made it to the top of the world, but even in his own daydream, he couldn't pull it off and ended up crashing and burning. And Q was still the one with all the juice.
And I think that's what we call a munch today.
He's a munch.
His pursuit of power and influence had him flying too close to the sun, and he crashed and burned in the end.
When you think about it, it's crazy how Bishop couldn't even figure out how to be the victor of his own fantasy turned nightmare.
Bruh, hopefully when Bishop comes to from this daydream, he'll think twice about taking on a life of crime in pursuit of juice.
So that's our fan theory on the movie Juice.
If you made it this far in the video, type "I got the juice" in the comments so we'll know you're one of the real ones who watched the fan theory to the end.
Don't forget to like this video and subscribe to the channel, and check out one of our other videos on the screen right now.